Lead architect for the Windows Server Division, ladies and gentlemen, I'd like to welcome you, distinguished engineer, Jeffrey Snover.
Wow, that was some introduction. Welcome, I'm Jeffrey Snover, distinguished engineer, now lead architect for Windows Server. I've been in the industry 30 years now and seen a lot of things come and go. And I thought for today's talk, I'd use some of that experience and scar tissue to give you my perspective on some things that are going on in the industry. I think there's some fundamental shifts here, and they'll affect the way we do things. Throughout my entire career, I've had a passion for IT pros. That didn't come up very much. So I've had a passion for making IT pros successful. Throughout my career, I've been focused in on what does it take for IT pros to be successful. And in particular, what I think I see now is that some changes in the industry require changes in the way we do things, the way IT pros do things, to continue being successful. So some of the things I talk about here today may make you feel a little bit uncomfortable, but I want you to hear them in a way that says, that is to say, that I'm here to try and help you understand these things so that you can have a strategy for how to deal with them, have fun with it, and then prosper, right? For me, success is IT pros increasing their salaries, right? So that's what success is for me, okay?
That's for me too, I like that.
I thought I'd start off with a story about Kurt Vonnegut, right? Kurt Vonnegut, great author, lots of books, and he was once at a book club, where a young kid says, "Mr. Vonnegut, I've read all your books, and it seems to me that what you're trying to say is that life has its ups and downs, but that courtesy must prevail." And Kurt Vonnegut said, "Oh, well, I'm delighted and dismayed that my entire literary career can be summed up in so few words." And with that, it turned out at the end of my talk, I realized that my entire talk today can be summed up in a few words. And that's from Don Jones, one of our speakers today. Don has famously said, "Learn college level, practice the phrase, would you like fries with that?" My conclusion for this talk is that as an industry, we need to learn to automate things or basically become irrelevant. And I'll make the case for why I believe that is the case. More precisely, I'm going to draw the distinction between what some people are now calling blue-collar IT and white-collar IT, and the threats to blue-collar IT. Right? Blue-collar IT is the rack and stack, I'm hell with a screwdriver, stand on my way, but also the point-and-click IT, as opposed to more the white-collar IT, which is more the systems integration, business consultant, crafting custom solutions to business problems. Okay. So this chart, I like this chart, right? So this one, I realized that, I heard someone recently, one of these pundits, saying, throwing some rocks at Microsoft's cloud activities, and they were very pessimistic about it. And then I looked at this chart and recalled, I remember way back when, and Microsoft said, "We're going to be in the server business." And do you remember that? People were like laughing. The IBM guys were like, "Oh, little desktop company." VMS, I was at Digital at the time, laughing. "Oh, little PC." Well, those guys aren't laughing so much. Those were the others. They're not laughing so much these days. So it really kind of highlights that what the reality of this shows is that Microsoft's incapable of sustained error. And we make mistakes all the time. But the great thing that I love about Microsoft is we're incapable of sustaining error. We're a culture of self-criticism. We look where we've done bad, and then we put together a program to fix it. And so you see that that's actually worked out rather well. Okay. So what this is showing you is the ship rates of servers by year, and how many. And you just see year after year, there you see the crash, the economic downturn, but then it's returned and shipping quite widely. So there's a few things to draw from this. First is, today, out of 76% of all servers that ship with Windows Server on. That's huge.
Yeah.
The second is, these numbers are really, really big. Okay, so there's a lot of servers, okay? But while this is impressive, this chart actually hides what's really going on. Okay, so let's discuss what's really going on. This is what's really going on, okay? This is a graph of the installed base of machines. And you see this bottom line here, right? This worldwide server shipments, that line was the previous chart, okay? So what that says, as much as that number is growing, it's actually small compared to the installed base of servers, okay? And what you see here is that virtualization, so this middle block says, hey, these are all the installed base of servers, and that red block is the installed base of virtual servers worldwide. And so what we're seeing is that virtualization is basically pouring jet fuel on this enormous fire already. I mean, the number of things that are out there is just phenomenal. Now, what that means is a couple things. One is, everyone has a lot more things to deal with. And basically, if you're still trying to point and click your way through life, things are going to become increasingly difficult. That's going to become increasingly a failed strategy for you. Okay, I've got some concrete examples about that. Well, in particular, I'm heavily involved in PowerShell. It turns out that one of the largest, most active PowerShell community is VMware. So last year I went to VMworld, and I met with the people who started that. And I said, well, I'm curious, you know, it's not obvious that there would be a natural synergy between VMware and be hostile to us. So why did you get on board with PowerShell and adopt it so vigorously? I mean, you've got this fantastic community out there. And the guy said, well, it's just simple physics. He says, you know, when we have an installed base who is barely coping with what they had to do, when you add virtualization, now all of a sudden these admins have double, triple, 10 times as many things that they need to deal with. And his phrase was, once you introduce virtualization, you either automate or you die. Well, okay, that actually makes a lot of sense. So what I want to point out here is that sometimes changes in quantity produce a change in quality. It becomes something fundamentally different. And so that's what we're saying here, that a change in the number of servers that you have changed the way you need to deal with that, right? The way to get that in focus is marriage. If you have one marriage, it's one thing. If you're married to five people, that's something completely different. A change in quantity produces a change in quality. You go to jail for that stuff.
No.
So in reality, what we're experiencing is that we're in the middle of a fundamental shift in the industry. So fundamental shifts have happened before, right? Prior to Copernicus, man had certitude, right? We knew where we were. The Earth was the center of the universe. Everything revolved around the Earth, and the Earth was all centered upon man, right? God told us that. And after Copernicus, it's like, no, that's not true. And man had to create a new order, had to re-understand, you know, had to have a new concept of how things work, and to understand his role in that. Well, the same thing's happened here, right? Virtualization is merely accelerating a set of forces that were already in play. And these forces, just like the Copernican Revolution, require us to rethink things, understand how things are really going to be, and understand what our role in that is going to be. Because if we don't, bad things happen. So honestly, you will go out there and you'll find pundits who will tell you exactly what's going to happen. I don't think anybody knows what's going to happen. I certainly don't. But what I do know is the skills that are necessary for us to succeed, given a wide range of potential outcomes. So the conventional wisdom amongst the industry pundits is that virtualization is merely a springboard to cloud computing. Okay? So in the past, we had traditional computing, that server there, then you virtualized it. And now people are talking about this cloud computing. By the way, so how many people have cloud computing in focus? Yeah, not so many. Right, okay, one guy. Good, we should ask what it is. We recently had an MVP summit, right? Brought in all the MVPs, and I was on part of this cloud panel, senior guys in front of the room, and someone just asked the question, well, what is the cloud? 45 minutes later, everyone was totally confused. So, you know, there's a lot of thoughts on this stuff. In reality, you know, I like to say that, well, virtualization is a springboard, but it's an unpredictable springboard, right? Might go here, might go there, might go there. One way or the other, the thing that's clear is things are not going to stay the way they are today. And indeed, changes in the data center are going to require changes in IT. Okay, so what is this cloud computing? So now I'm going to give you my way. You know, have that mess at the MVP summit made me go off and think, you know, I thought I kind of knew what cloud computing was, at least in my own head. Well, when someone asked it, I didn't really have a good articulation of it. So I thought, well, I have to figure out what my articulation of that is. And by the way, this is just mine. You might find somebody else has a different articulation. But this helps me think about things and helps me gain clarity on things. So the first thing is that people conflate two things, right? When talk about one thing when in fact they should be two. In fact, that's actually my definition of architecture. So you say, what is architecture? I said, architecture is the art of deciding when two things ought to be one and one thing ought to be two. Okay? So cloud computing ought to be two conversations. There's this architectural conversation. Originally I said architecture, and it's not really an architecture like I like to think of an architecture. It's really more of an architectural gestalt, sort of like this, right? And that's things like delivering IT as a service, okay? Having elastic computing, where you can go from small to large to small to medium, being very elastic. And self-healing, right? Intrinsic to all definitions of the cloud are, if something goes wrong, things don't go pear-shaped, people don't go running around, it's like, yeah, you went wrong, just automatically failed over. You know, if there are too many of those things, you might need to deal with it. And indeed, with these large data centers, they're really quite fascinating. If you've ever been to one, they're just phenomenal. They have hard drives that just fail, you know, no big deal. X period of time, every week, every couple weeks, they send some guy around with a card, and the bottom he's got a bunch of fresh drives, and he goes and he pulls out the bad one, throws it in, puts a good one in, just no big deal. So the ability to deal with failures automatically is intrinsic to all this cloud computing. And another element of cloud computing is that end users do a lot of their own administration through self-service portals. Okay? So these are the things I like to say with it, the architectural gestalt. Now then there's a completely separate conversation, and that's what I like to call the cloud business model. Cloud business model basically says, I'm not running the stuff here, you're running the stuff there, and I pay you when I want to, okay, or when I need stuff. Okay? So basically you're buying IT services from somebody else, it's pay for use. Hey, I have that thing, I pay for it, I'm done with it, I'm not paying you anymore. And this is this distinction between private cloud and public cloud. You've heard that. So the way I think of that is private cloud, public cloud. They're both this cloud gestalt, right? Elastic, failover, self-service portals. But the private versus public is all around this business model, right? Public cloud is, they're your machines, somebody else's machines, and I pay real cash for them. Private cloud is, no, I'm going to buy machines, and I'm just going to configure them so that they have this cloud gestalt, but I own the machines, right, and I run the machines. And obviously in that world, there's limits to the scalability, right? So in the public world, they say, hey, I'd like 1,000 machines, probably you can get 1,000 machines in a matter of minutes. On the private cloud, maybe you do, and maybe you say, well, I can give you 500, but after that, I got to order some more servers to deal with that, and that'll take a couple months. Whereas in the public cloud, that's not the case. So anyway, that's the way to think about this private versus public cloud. And then there's this notion of hybrids. Someone has told me recently that they spend a lot of time discussing hybrid cloud because people didn't realize that these can exist. Absolutely. Hybrids, there's no all or nothing here. You can have traditional IT computing and add a little bit of cloud architecture to that, you're calling it or it calling you, as well as the business model. You can have some things on-premise and some things off-premise, and anybody who tells you something different is trying to sell you something, so treat that. By the way, that's one of my big messages here is listen to all this stuff. It's very, very important. But take it all with a grain of salt, right? Just to say, hey, these big revolutions, and this big is a big revolution, they take a while to play themselves out. Right? They take a while to figure out what really, you know, you thought you were going to go to Seattle, you ended up in Denver, right? Because things change. Anyway, so one popular conceptualization of the future is IT as a service. Okay, so when you say that, IT is a service. Well, what is a service? I went to the dictionary, and they had a pretty reasonable definition. Is that the service is work done by somebody, for somebody, at somebody else, as a job, a duty, a punishment, or a favor. Okay, so intrinsic. So we have these different services, right? There's infrastructure as a service. Sometimes people like to call this x86 as a service, right? And so they just say, well, look, I just want a machine and, you know, an x86, and I'm going to put my operating system on it, and you don't do anything other than that, but when I want one right away, and I might want 1,000, and I want 10,000, and then I want 5. And so you have that flexibility, but what you're getting is basically just a machine, okay? And then you have to do all the rest yourself. Then there's platform as a service. Now, platform as a service is, you know, these things like Azure, and these are, hey, you're going to write your code differently, and issues of like failover are intrinsic to this. So if you write your code this way, the platform will give you elasticity and fault tolerance. And then there's software as a service, and software as a service just basically says, hey, you wanted SharePoint, Exchange, whatever, and you can run it on-premise, or you can just run it in the cloud, and we'll run it for you, okay? So intrinsic to each of these layers is management. You can't do any of these things without management. In fact, they just go hand in hand. The concept of any of these things without a rich, deep automation service is just inconceivable, okay? Now, let me get to, sometimes these concepts are a little bit fuzzy, so let me ground them in some specifics to help get it in focus. Okay, so product mapping. For the infrastructure as service, that really translates to Windows Server and System Center, okay, right? Base capability of the management. For platform as a service, that's our Azure platform, and then again, System Center to manage it. And then the software as a service are things like Office 365, Office 365, Windows Intune, and Microsoft Dynamics. Now, another way that I found very useful, because these terms get tossed around, and again, they're like, what do you mean? Something I found very useful was when someone said, think about who consumes these services, or consumes these layers. For infrastructure as a service, who consumes that? Who's the customer for that? And the answer is IT pros. Who consumes platform as a service? Well, it's developers. In other words, developers have to write code. They have to modify their code for platform as a service. IT pros don't use platform as a service, right? They might manage the resultant product, but they won't use platform as a service directly. And then software as a service, that's focused in on customers. Hey, I'm a customer, I'm the CEO, and I've decided, hey, I just want somebody else to do this. I don't want to invest in that myself. I want somebody in these conversations. Now, there's this difference between the pundits versus the IT pros, right? And there's a bit of cloud doubting going on, right? Cloud, what cloud? There's a CIO survey that claimed that only 7% of the people were likely to use cloud services. And then 47% said, well, we might do some of our own. We might have some private cloud. At this MVP summit, I heard a very strong statement from the IT pros. Cloud? What cloud? What are you talking about? Why are you wasting my time? What is this about? This is not part of my reality. This is not part of my customer's reality. I don't want this. Stop bothering me. And so, okay, great. So I thought about that. I was like, well, why is that? And so I drilled in, and people were able to talk, you know, point out this flaw, that flaw, that flaw, that flaw, and why it was completely inappropriate to use the cloud for what they wanted to do. And I realized this was like the innovator's dilemma. If you're not familiar with the innovator's dilemma, it basically says when a company is successful, the very things that made them successful cause them a dilemma and causes them to be subverted. So a newcomer will come along, like, say, Windows and Linux, right? Windows were very successful. Take a little look at Linux, and originally you say, oh, it's got this problem, it's got that problem. Nobody could possibly use that. And so you discount it. And then over time, but there's something about this new entrant that people find compelling, that they use it for niche areas. And then having established itself well in a niche area, then it addresses the problems and does well, okay? And you've certainly seen that in Linux, and we're responding to that quite vigorously. Well, the same thing's happening in the cloud. Indeed, people point out issues of governance and security, and oh, Amazon went down, and these people went down. It's like, yep, all true, but they're all doing very, very well. And why? And the answer is, there's a certain segment of needs that the benefits of the cloud are so strong that they're using them despite all those problems, and then those problems are going to get addressed. Okay? So that's the way this is going to happen. And so in biology, right, evolutionary theory, there's this notion of punctuated equilibrium, okay? And a little bit of a controversial theory, but basically it says, hey, you know, the animals probably didn't go from, like, not having wings to, go through a series of steps to having wings, right? Probably like a half wing probably wasn't that useful. So like, why would you have a half wing? And the theory is that it goes along, and then there's some change in the environment, and over a very short period of time, you have very large changes. And so indeed, we've seen that before, where all of a sudden it's like, no, 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 and then you have this very large change, and you're at a different level. I'll point out the iPad, right? The iPad, you know, there's, you know, traditional desktops, you had notebooks, and then all of a sudden, boom, the iPad. And now this year at the latest conference, there were 50 some odd different tablets. So that's an example of this punctuated equilibrium, where you go along and then you have these big changes. So as you chew on this, what you realize is that a lot of IT, you know, major fundamental changes to IT have all been subversive changes. Okay? Back in the days of the mainframe, IT was mainframe computing. And then some idiot in a department had too much budget and bought his own VAX. Shark. You know, that's not part of IT. What are they doing? And then those idiots hired an admin for this. What is going on? And boom, we had the era of departmental computing. And that was going fine. Now IT was in departmental computing. And then some jerk went out and bought a PC. What the heck's that thing? You know, that doesn't follow our rules. You didn't ask me. You know, how are you going to manage it? What about the governance? Da da da. And they just keep buying these things. So then IT became the desktop business. So what I realized when I chewed on this is IT is often the post facto cleanup of the reality somebody else made. No, it's true. It's true. Think about it. And this really came home as I saw one of the Azure test cases, or showcases, case studies. Now what it was a large auto manufacturer, and they were showing how, their marketing guys were having this big campaign, right? They wanted to roll it out with this big web presence and all this. And what they did was, they had some budget. So they hired some consultants, and these consultants used Azure to become very productive and wrote this, you know, fantastic application very, very quickly that could scale up to whatever they needed to. And they rolled this thing out, and they were wildly successful. And they're just like, it's wonderful, wonderful. And it's a very moving example. But as I thought about it, I'm like, what about the IT department? Like, these guys have now produced an artifact that those consultants are probably going to go away, and the IT department's going to have to pick up and own, and, oh, I get it. IT is cleaning up the reality somebody else has made, right? Because I guarantee if that marketing department had gone to IT and said, hey, we need a web presence, and we need that about a quarter, they, you know, we all know what that conversation would have.
Yeah, yeah, you know, smoking dope, those marketing guys. Anyway, so that's what happens. So, you know, cloud doubters, you know, it's fine, but it's going to happen. There's stuff going on here. So, you know, it may take, cloud may take a long time to become a dominant force, but it really would be too foolish to ignore it. So I thought I'd take a few minutes to explain why I think this is inevitable. You know, make the case for why this is inevitable and what's going to happen here. Okay? So my background's in physics, Spike, friends. Physics, man. Physics is great. And the great thing about physics is you learn to, like, take a look at a lot of data and try and distinguish what's relevant and what's irrelevant. Get at the physics of the situation, the laws, the immutable things. And so when I became lead architect of Windows, it was around the time we were just amping up our conversation. Cloud, 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 we're all in the cloud. And I thought to myself, good Lord, did I just become the lead architect of the Titanic? I mean, this is just... And so I thought, well, I don't know what to think about that. And so I thought about it and investigated this, and I heard things like, oh, the great thing about the cloud is, like, things like Azure will handle the patching for you. You don't even have to be bothered with that. And at first glance, that resonated. Like, yeah, you know, patching is a real pain in the butt. You know, why would you want to deal with that? And the fact that Azure's just going to do that for you, that's great. And then I thought about it. I was thinking, well, geez, now imagine you're the CIO of, like, Target. And you just found out, well, hey, you know, the day before, you know, right after Thanksgiving, your busiest time, Azure's going to patch all your servers for you. And then I thought about, so I'm involved in Windows Next. I guess now we can call it the code name Windows 8. And we don't know what it's going to be called, but it's the next version of Windows. And I was thinking about some of the, by the way, the next version of Windows is going to be awesome. And I realized at the MVP Summit, we had this strange conversation where there was this high anxiety and people were like freaking out. I was like, what is going on here? And then it hit me. We screwed up. I'll just say, we screwed up. We did two things simultaneously and it had the wrong effect. The first thing is, we got very public about our dedication to the cloud. We're all in. Cloud, 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 we're all in. It's true, it's great. The second thing we did is when it came to Windows, we said, we're not talking about Windows. Right? The reason why we're not talking about Windows is in the client space, right, they're competing against Apple and the consumer space, that's the big thing we wanted to go do. And in that environment, you just want to be quiet, quiet, quiet until you then build out this big thing. So we don't want things leaking out, et cetera. So we're quiet about the next version of Windows until we talk about it. And having done that, all up in the cloud and then quiet on Windows, these MVPs were like, is Windows dead? I said, oh my God, no. Windows is not dead. Windows you will be shocked at how wonderful the next version of Windows is. Anyway, so I was looking at some of the features that we had in Windows and some of the options that we were going to give you around controlling bandwidth and latency. And I said, well, hey, those are going to be great, but how do you do those in the cloud? And the answer is, not so much. So what this then helped me kind of get in focus was that the cloud is on-premise computing, and then there's, you know, off-premise computing, or what I call the cloud business model. And the essence of these things, there's an essence to it. The essence of the cloud business model is that it is elastic and affordable. Okay, these are the immutables. That on any given day, I can go from one server to 10,000 servers, back down to one server, just with, you go to a web portal saying, make it so, and it just happens like that. You really can't do that on-premise, okay? Next is it's inexpensive when you use it, right? Because you only pay, well, first we get some great efficiency, so it's inexpensive. But then you only pay when you use it, okay? So there's an essence there that's just real. And then on-premise, it's all about control. So elastic versus control. On-premise, I get to control, you know, the physical access and security of my boxes. I can take my server and I can put it in the corner of my room. I can say, don't go near me. Or if I'm smarter, I can put it in a locked cage until, you know,
key code that only I know. I know I can control who has access to that. I can control the configuration and the chain, when what gets changed and when it changes, and I can control my costs. Now my costs might be higher, but I control them. Okay? And I get to control my latency and bandwidth, right? I can configure my network in such a way that I can control things. I can go and I can say, hey, put those two things right next to each other, buy a faster router, your switch, whatever. I can control those things. So these are the two immutable things, elasticity versus control. Now in reality, what's going to happen is, is that over time, what you're going to see is that the cloud is going to provide more and more control, and on-premise is going to provide more and more elasticity, right? I don't think you'll ever have one, them completely overlapping, but they'll become more like, and so it's all good. Oh, anyway, so the reason I point this out is it's important to have this in focus and to refer back to it when you hear some sensational claims that you'll hear. And use this to help put those things in perspective. When somebody says, everything's going to the cloud next year and on-premise computing, you look at this and say, well, what about some of these issues here? And if you hear somebody say, oh, the cloud's dead, nobody's ever going to go to the cloud, what cloud? You look at that and say, well, I don't know, that was pretty compelling. So you can use this perspective to hopefully gain a little perspective. So here what I want to talk about is economics really matters, right? So imagine the case that you're going to buy a server, right? How much would that cost? Now imagine you go talk to the salesperson and say, hey, I'm thinking about buying 10. What kind of a discount will you give me? You probably get a pretty reasonable discount. What if you said, hey, I'm going to buy 100. What kind of discount could you get? What if you said, hey, I'd like to buy 1,000 servers from you? Can you imagine a salesperson? And somebody says, I'm going to buy 1,000 high-end servers from you, that guy is probably going crazy, right? You make his entire budget for the entire year, right? That would be a very good day for those guys. So at 1,000, and then once you got to 1,000, so anyways, if you buy a machine, you buy 1,000 servers, you probably get a really good price for them. And at 1,000 servers, you're really going to have to automate. And so by automating, you're going to drive down your costs even further, right? Make it even more economical. Right? So kind of intuitively, we can look at this and we can say that 1,000 server data center is probably more efficient than 100 server one, right? I think most people would agree with that. Well, there's some guys out there that did quantitative analysis, okay? So public cloud economies, right? So there's a paper out there, I encourage you to all go read it. It really is something we all need to get in focus, okay? So it's the Economics of the Cloud by Rolf Hans and Michael Yamatino. And basically they make the case for why there are such great economies of scale in the cloud. And one of the things they talk about is the supply side economics. So you thought buying 1,000 servers was cheap, but when you buy them 10,000 at a time, you sort of get to tell people what the price is. When you buy energy megawatts at a time, you get a much better price than plugging it into a wall socket, right? When you go and you build your data center, like right next to the electric, the hydroelectric plant, you get even better rates. Okay? I don't know if you knew that. That's one of the tricks that people do, is you build your data center right next to the electrical plant. Because it turns out, it's far cheaper to transmit bits than it is watts. So what is computing? Computing, it transforms watts, energy, into bits, information. And it turns out that transmitting bits is really inexpensive. Transmitting watts is actually expensive because there are lots of inefficiencies in transferring power long distances, whereas with data, there isn't. So really fascinating. And by the way, once you put the plants next to these electrical facilities, I get much better rates, and you get kind of first choice, better reliability of your data. Oh, your energy, excuse me. Anyway, And then when you have these very large systems, you can build automation, and basically people are expensive, right? But they're not expensive when you can amortize them over tens of thousands per server, right? So, you know, you have admin ratios of, you know, tens of thousands of servers per admin, or that's pretty cheap, okay? Then they also go and make the case about how aggregation, being able to take lots of workloads, and variability, I got tax people, tax software that has a peak in April, for April hopefully, and then I've got the realtors, and what this means is this large aggregation of stuff allows you to do some efficiencies. Hey, I'm going to sell you the server for this Thanksgiving, and then I'm going to sell the same server to you for tax season, and you're not paying for it during the tax season, and you're not paying for it during Thanksgiving, but it's my computer, and you know, I get some great efficiencies, okay? And they go through a lot of details, right? Throughout the day, there's different things, and so I can reuse the same compute resources to different customers at the different times of day, etc. And then when you go and you rewrite your software to be multi-tenancy, you can get even greater efficiencies, okay? So, you know, it turns out our intuition was right. Right? 1,000 server data center was more efficient than 100 data center. Right? So this is the number of servers versus the total cost of ownership per server. So look at this, at 100, the cost is way up there. And between 100 and 1,000, you look at that, right? Just phenomenal, right? So our intuition was right. But here, it's not as obvious between 1,000 and 100,000, but in fact, between 1,000 and 100,000 servers, there's an 80% reduction in TCO. 80%. That is freaking amazing. Okay? It doesn't look it, but it is. Okay? So remember, these changes in quantity produces changes in quality. Okay? So if you're doubting, oh, cloud, you know, you're gonna buy a server, I'm gonna buy a server, it's in cloud versus not. No. There are some fundamental economics here that are just compelling, okay? So, this is a phrase that I use, right? Technologies that matter are technologies that produce a compelling economic advantage. This was the driving force behind the design of Windows PowerShell. I applied it to that on everything, and it applies to PowerShell and applies to the cloud as well, right? That there are some compelling economic advantages to doing cloud computing. So running your stuff on public cloud computing may be inevitable, but maybe not. Okay? So let's drill into the cloud a little bit more to understand why it may be and why it may not be. Okay. So Alfred Northhead had this wonderful quote, he's a scientist, philosopher of science. He said, civilization advances by extending the number of important operations we can perform without thinking about it. And if you think about it, that's sort of the definition of automation. Okay? Automation is at the heart of both the cloud architecture and the cloud business model. Okay? And notice that distinction, architecture versus business model. It's an important distinction. So let's start with cloud architecture. Automation in the cloud architecture, that automation is what drives everything, right? It drives the provisioning of the raw hardware, provides the provision, the configuration of the software, the monitoring of things, and the automatic failover from error states, the recovery, and all the management, right? That's how you get these tens of thousands of servers per admin. It's through automation, okay? And it's not just automating, one set of things. You've got to automate the entire set of things that go into the compute element, right? So the servers, the networking, the load balancing, the operating system, the middleware, the applications, everything. And in the world of the cloud, there's this maniacal focus on what they call site up. Site up is the number one thing. That means, is my site up and running, okay? And everything you self-organize around site up. And what happens is whenever there's a failure, okay, there's a failure, site went down. First, fix it, and second, make sure that never happens again. If that ever happens again, people are getting fired. So let's figure out what went wrong and let's put things in place. And so what you see is it drives this continuous improvement and automation. Okay. So recently there was a lot of press about the Amazon cloud outage. Right. So they had an outage. Very big thing. They did a very good job of recovering from it and writing up their things. And in their write-up of it, what they said was, so the Amazon service disruption, they said, we will audit our change process and increase the automation to prevent this mistake from happening in the future. So errors are, people respond to errors with automation, okay? So automation is at the heart of the cloud architecture. Okay, for both public and the private cloud. Now let's talk about the business model, right? Here too, automation is the primary factor in these high server to admin ratios. And that's what allows us to drive down the costs, right? To be able to offer this. If you didn't have automation, you really couldn't have cloud economics, right? You'd have outsourcing. By the way, that's another way people like to think of the cloud. Think of it as the next generation of outsourcing. Okay, but that's say the cloud business model. But the difference is that traditional outsourcing, you didn't have this fundamental shift in economics. The cloud computing's outsourcing is fundamental shift in economics. And automation is obvious, right? That's what empowers all these self-service portals. So automation enables both the architecture and the business model of the cloud. Now, here's where it gets interesting. Right? So the public cloud, public cloud drives automation, automation drives the public cloud. Here's the deal. People are expensive. People cost a lot of money. Next, people break stuff. The whole AWS thing was somebody went in there and they made a change and they made the change wrong. They broke stuff. Therefore, anything that requires thought, anything that requires judgment, anything that, there are questions, there are options, right? These things require people. So if you can minimize these things, you can minimize people, and you can minimize costs and service disruptions. Okay? Right? So that's what I said. Some of this stuff might feel a little uncomfortable. But wait, bear with me. It's well worth getting this in focus. So someone said when they tried to automate the car industry, remember Saturn? The original vision for a Saturn factory was that it would be entirely lights out and there would be only two living things in the factory, a guard and a dog. And the role of the guard was to feed the dog, and the role of the dog was to bite the guard if he tried to touch anything. that's how these guys think about these things. Okay? But the point of this, here's the net. But the public cloud is up because of this. Because of this, the public cloud is optimized to deliver a relatively small set of standardized scenarios. Right? You're not going to get infinite options. You're not going to go up and say, hey, you might be given gold, silver, and bronze. Right? You might go say, well, I like bronze, but I'd like to have these 17 changes. Like, hit the road, buddy. That's not going to happen. Right? It's not going to happen. Why? And this is why. Because those 17 changes require people, and people break them all. Okay? So, and there's an opportunity. The cloud is compelling for standardized scenarios. Okay? We've seen this before, right? Henry Ford. Customer can have any color. As long as it's black. Lots of industries have gone through this transformation of scale and automation. Okay? So is this the end of local servers and admins? And the answer is maybe. Maybe. It's a distinct possibility. But maybe not. Okay? So let me give you a couple examples. McDonald's. You could have the following analysis. Hey, I've looked at the numbers, and McDonald's buys beef at such large scale, their economies of scales, their cost, these high-end steakhouses, they're screwed. They're just going away. McDonald's is just going to put them all out of business. And the answer is that's not really true, right? Ruth Chris's is doing really quite nice. There are lots of very high-end steakhouses. And even though I can get meat at McDonald's for a much cheaper price, they've not put them out of business. And why is that, right? And the answer is it's different. Right? You're not getting a crummy hamburger at Ruth Chris's. You're getting a really nice steak. You're getting an experience. You're getting something different, and honestly, the prices are, you know, expensive, but they're in the ballpark, right? If the same experience was $1,000, Ruth Chris's, they'd be out of business, right? Okay, but it's in the ballpark, and it's a differentiated offering. Now then, let me contrast that against tailored clothing, right? It used to be clothing a long time ago. Clothing was all made by hand. Now, that's not the case, right? Now you get a shirt that's small, medium, large, extra large, right? They're standardized sets. And in fact, you could go get tailored clothing. You'd say, hey, you can measure my body, my exact shirt, and you can do that. But it's very, very expensive, and the incremental value of a tailored shirt versus a non-tailored shirt mean that only the very, very richest of people and those people with very, very special needs spend money on that. Most of us deal with standardized offerings, okay? So here are these two worlds, right? McDonald's didn't put those steakhouses out of business. By the way, if you're charging those prices and delivering just a crummy hamburger, you're gonna go out of business there. So if you offer the standard, you compete by offering the same thing but at a higher price, that's not gonna work. But then if you're not offering enough differentiation, that's not gonna work either, okay? So basically the net here is that highly differentiated solutions, they compete quite nicely if they're in the ballpark. Now here's the sad news. Sad news is much of IT just is not in the ballpark, right? Much of IT is very inefficient. It's very, you know, the servers to admin numbers are not very good. Okay, so that's gotta change. Now, the public cloud is still gonna need admins, but it's gonna need, you know, so if solutions go to the public cloud, is that the end of IT? No, it's not the end of IT. It'll still need admins, but there'll be fewer, and it'll be a polarized set of skills, okay? You'll have admins, but they're gonna be admins like what we used to call secretary type admins, right? A self-service portal where I go and I say, here's my new user, and they get bronze. Oh, here's a new user, and they get gold, okay? Don't need a high skill set to do those functions. So those are the low-end admins. But you'll also have the higher-end admins. They, hey, that's great, but it's gotta fit into our systems. You know, we're gonna integrate it as part of our overall IT and integrate it with the rest of our systems. So high-end IT, the blue-collar IT, not so well. The high-end, the white-collar IT, where we do systems integration, we do business consulting, tell them, hey, I understand your business, I understand technology, and I can tell you how to map these two things to yield the maximum benefit. Those things do well. So basically, the challenge to the point in the blue-collar, what I call rack-and-stack point-and-click IT. White-collar IT, I think, is going to do quite well. Now, again, white-collar IT, systems integration, okay? I like to say that there are three standard tools for systems integration. First, the mouse, right? Click, 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 or the GUI, okay? Second, the pen. Hey, IBM, how much do I have to write a check for to make this problem go away? Okay? Cloud, how much do I have to write a check for to make this problem go away? And the third is PowerShell. Okay, PowerShell, those are the three tools of automation. Systems integration. Systems integration through the mouse, I'm very pessimistic about its future. Systems integration from the pen, I think that will continue to exist. I think people will write fewer checks to IBM Global Services and more to cloud providers. But then automation through PowerShell, I think systems integration through PowerShell, I think has a very strong future. So, as Don says, fries with that, how do we avoid this? A lot of blue-collar IT might end up working at McDonald's, right? So how do we avoid this? First is to update to the latest versions of software, right? I was just telling this gentleman before the talk that we had this situation, a competitive situation, where it looked like we were gonna lose an Exchange customer to Gmail. And so, boy, the exec got on that. Hey, what's going on? What's going on? What's going on? How can this be possible? And they said, well, the customer really wants to get these following features from Gmail, A, B, and C. And he says, what are you talking about? We've had those since Exchange 2007. 2010 is even better. I said, yeah, but the customer's on 2003. Okay. So if you're not up to speed on the latest versions of our software. Look, they're the latest versions for reasons, right? We don't just buildings for no reason. You know, we talk to customers. What is it that you need? What best serves your business? And we put them into the latest versions. The degree to which you're not delivering those to your customer means that you're not delivering the things that the marketplace has said the businesses need. And therefore, you know, they're going to look and say, hey, well, maybe I just sidestep you guys. And just like that, the marketing department did to get their ad campaign on the web, they might say, hey, you know, IT is just not meeting my needs. I'm going to subvert them and just go get my own answer, my own solution over here. Okay? So, you know, delivering the latest stuff is super, super important. It's got the latest, you know, it's got the best features. It has the greatest security and, to your benefit, has the greatest manageability. So you can take those offerings, the latest offerings, most of now PowerShell, most products in Microsoft are now PowerShell enabled, and you can use that to create custom solutions, high value solutions that are highly differentiated from something that they could get in the cloud. It's really hard to do that with Exchange 2003. It is. 2007 you can do it, 2010 you can do it very well. Okay? And then, so how do you deliver these high value, low cost, high quality solutions? Got a three-step program for that. First, automate your solutions. Second, automate. Third, automate.
Yeah.
Any confusion on this point? I can start over. No, really, automation. It's the heart of the business model. It's the heart of the public cloud offering. And even if you're not going to go to the cloud offering, you're going to do traditional IT, automation is what allows you to go perform these very difficult things in ways that are simple, that are repeatable, that are high quality, and can produce a differentiated solution to your business, right? So basically, it's this transition. You've got to transition from white-collar IT to blue-collar IT to white-collar IT. So here's the acid test. You think about your job. You say, hey, you know what? I spend the bulk of my week just clicking the mouse buttons the way everybody clicks the mouse buttons, you know? You're probably not a good smart. You probably want to say, hey, I should be doing something different. I got some examples of that coming up. So in the Windows ecosystem, automation really does translate into PowerShell. Now there's things built on top of PowerShell, System Center, great set of products, but in reality, it's automation, the heart of it is PowerShell. PowerShell is a distributed automation engine that gets surfaced as an interactive scripting environment, an interactive shell, that's PowerShell.exe. In fact, I don't know if you know this, PowerShell.exe is a really, 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 really tiny program that brings in a really big distributed automation engine. That distributed automation engine can be used lots of different places, right? PowerShell is really this engine. So, example, the Exchange admin GUI, the entire GUI is written on top of this automation engine. PowerShell.exe really just says, print out a prompt, read a line, give it to the automation engine, take the results, print it to the screen, do it again. It's called a REPL loop. Read, execute, print, loop. Yeah, very tiny. Okay? So, in addition to that, you surface it in an API and a remote interface, right? You remote lots of different machines. These commandlets, now, by the way, I should have asked, how many people are already familiar with PowerShell? Okay, great. So those of you who aren't, we focus on this thing called a commandlet. A commandlet is a high-level task-oriented abstraction. What we ultimately want to get to is a world where you think about what you want, you type it, and you get it. Okay? I want to get the processes where the handle counts are greater than 500. I want to sort them by handle count. I want to format it as a table with the name, the handle count, and the product. And you know, that's a PowerShell command. That's literally what you do. There's a little syntax to it, but that's literally what you're typing. And now the scripting language, honestly, we had a long discussion about this last night. It's going to take us a long time, perhaps never, will we ship the things that directly do your job. Because as I pointed out last night, it's like, if the thing that you need is, you know, do my job / work me a pizza, wake me up, hand my shift, right? If we actually delivered that job to you, that function to you, then you know what I could do is say, yeah, do her job and fire her. So ultimately we want you to be able to do that, but we will never be able to deliver those things, and you'll have to create your own, right? You want your own high-level abstraction. That's what the scripting environment's about. the scripting environment is about taking the things we deliver and making them yours, making them meet your business needs, et cetera. So that's what it's really all about. And then our goal is to try and provide that, allow you to craft your custom solutions as high a level as possible. There's more and more high-level testing and abstractions. So this is why I say, when you do automation, coverage is king. You need to be able to deal with everything. You need to be able to talk to WSMan, to WMI, to COM, to .NET, etc. Honestly, those are abstractions that are low-level abstractions, so you can deal with these high-level things. In reality, it's going to take us a while to do that. If there's ever a gap, you know that with PowerShell, there's no gap. You can always get things done, even if you have to operate at a lower level. Now, the great thing about this is the community is filled with geeks that love doing this stuff. So there's a chance if you ever come across someone that says, I need to do this, but it's all in this low-level abstraction, you can just go out to the community and say, hey, does anybody have something that can help me? James O'Neill. Oh my God, James O'Neill. I owe him such a debt of gratitude. I was doing a talk for a keynote talk where I was doing this consolidated demo. It was originally done in like three different talks on lots of different people. And we put it all on one laptop with this hideously complex set of instructions to stop all the VMs, start this checkpoint in this VM, then this one, and then this one, and then do a demo, then shut it all down, and then start these four, and then I had like four or five of these demos that were all like that. And I was going to be the only one. Right? Typically, it's like somebody's off doing this by hand, and the other person's talking, and I was going to be the only one. I thought, oh my God, that's not going to work. So I have to automate this. And if you took a look at the automation for a hypervisor, right, all these like low-level WMI things, and I just said, oh, I'm going to die. And it turned out James O'Neill had taken those low-level WMI abstractions and produced high-level task-oriented abstractions in commandlets. And I was able to get his commandlets, quickly put together a solution for my talk, gave the talk, had number one talk of the entire conference, went flawlessly. James O'Neill, guy in the community, saved my life by allowing me to automate a set of things that I was uncomfortable with automating. He was able to take those low-level things using PowerShell, transform those low-level abstractions into high-level abstractions. So, huge success there. Oh, I'm sorry. And so, coverage. We are, inexorably, year by year, quarter by quarter, year by year, increasing the number of things that have high-level task-oriented commandlets. There's something called the Common Engineering Criteria. Yeah? Here, this is where we say, hey, if you're a Microsoft product and you wanted to ship, did you want to ship? You want to ship, yeah. Then here are the things you have to do. And one of them is full coverage from PowerShell. And so you've just seen year after year, I don't know if you've taken a look at the new Link server. Obviously SharePoint's been out there for a while. The new Link server has full PowerShell support. So we're doing a much better job on this. So PowerShell in the cloud. You just can't swing a cat without finding PowerShell in the cloud, right? So I gave you the example of VMware, right? You can't automate, you're going to automate or drown with virtualization. So too in the hosters, these guys, all these Rackspace and Facebook, they're all using PowerShell. They look at the stuff we're delivering, they just couldn't survive without that. There's something called DevOps. DevOps is a new model that says, hey, your developers and your operators, your IT, really ought to work together as a team to develop solutions. And there's a couple popular products in that space. One of them's called Chef. And they've now recently, they were really a Linux-focused environment, and now they're trying to extend into Windows. And they're doing that by incorporating PowerShell. Exchange Hosted Services. Literally, Exchange Hosted Services would not have been possible without PowerShell. That thing's entirely automated through PowerShell. The management service that you see across the wire is done through PowerShell. Office 365, the same thing. It's all being automated through PowerShell. Azure itself, Azure internally being managed by PowerShell. We have something called GFS, our Global Foundation Services. These are the organization that runs all of Microsoft IT. That's all being used in PowerShell. And even Bing itself, Bing is its provisioning uses PowerShell. So, automation, as I said, automation is the heart of the cloud. Okay, So it just keeps getting better. I would love to be able to sit here and talk to you about the next version of Windows. I can't, but I can tell you this. Investments in automation, investments in learning the skill of automation is going to be well served. You're going to have a lot of things to apply those skills against in the next version of Windows. So we've got a build conference in September this year, and after that, we're going to have another conversation where I can give you all the details. You're going to like that conversation. It's going to be a very big release. So let me give you a couple examples of this. Again, I started by saying that, you know, I've got a passion around making IT pros successful. Last year at TechEd, I was on Bourbon Street, and this admin came up to me and just said, you know, thank you. I said, oh, for what? He says, you know, a year ago, my boss came to me, and he said, hey, you've got to learn PowerShell. And he said, hell no! I'm a GUI guy. I don't want to learn the scripting stuff. His boss said, I don't care. You got to learn it. He says, I didn't want to learn. He says, but said it was my job, so I learned it. He says, a week later, oh my gosh, I was having fun. You know, thank you so much for building a product that's so much fun. I'm just having a blast with it. He says, and so then a few weeks ago is my yearly review. And I knew what was gonna happen. He says, just like the, you know, my career topped out about 5 years ago. And so I knew I was gonna walk in there and I was gonna get a 1% raise, just like I had for the last 5 years. And I walked in, got the piece of paper, and said, thank you, and was walking out. He says, stop, sit down, read it. Okay, so that, am I in trouble? And read it, he says, I got a 17% raise. In last year's economy, right in the toilet, this guy got a 17% raise. And he said, his boss says, you know, since you learned PowerShell, you've just become so much more productive. You are kicking butt, and I just want to say thank you. You are so valuable to us, right? And I got to tell you, personally, that's like, that was just the best story I had heard, right? Because indeed, it's about making people successful, okay? And by the way, I'll just point out that, you know, if you're a manager, you know how this stuff works. You get a budget for salaries and promos and all that. You get a budget, and having given 17% to him meant there was less to give to other people, right? So who didn't get it? This guy invests in PowerShell, becomes more productive, gets a 17% raise. Somebody did. Next is another example at TechEd where someone came up to the booth and talked about, oh, you know, they just love PowerShell, it's great. And he talked about how the boss had come in and said, hey, I forget the details, but it's something where this is a crisis, this is a big deal. We've got to get all this information from all of our servers by the end of the week. And no excuses, you know. So work whatever hours, you know, if you have to tell your spouse you're gonna work nights, just do it. I gotta have that information by the end of the week, no excuses. Like, yes sir, yes sir, yes sir. He said, goes back to his desk and he says the pink one. He's like, wait a minute, something, we should do that with PowerShell. He said, 10 minutes later, he had the information. I said, wow, that's crazy, what'd you do? He says, well, I went home, of course. I took the afternoon off. When I came back in the morning and gave him the data, he thought I was a hero. It's a good story. All right. So, you know, Nietzsche once said there are no facts, there's only interpretation, right? So, you know, history's shown that people can be very, very bad at predicting the future, right? So everything I've said here could be completely wrong. But what I do know is that economics matter. Economics matter. Economics drive things. And there are economic forces at play that say we're under a fundamental shift, right? And that things have to change. And so too, economic forces changes, produce threats, they produce opportunities. PowerShell is a tool that allows you to get ahead of this and automation, but in reality, automation allows you to change the economics of the value you deliver to your customers by producing custom solutions, meeting their needs. If you're just providing standardized offerings, you know, there's a good chance that that activity is going to be replaced by automation. Yeah? So my call to actions, step away from the mouse.
Yes.
Upgrade the latest versions of things. That's how you deliver maximal value, because we invest in that. Chances are, if you have an EA, they've already bought it. There's no price, no money involved. It's just a matter of deployment. invest in your automation skills. It really is, every now and again, there's a time to like invest in skills, and then once you have those skills, you know, harvest the benefits of those skills. This is a time to invest in a set of skills, it really is. And then engage in the community. You don't have to do this by yourself. Like with James O'Neill and the PowerShell stuff, there's a set of stuff I would not have been successful at doing, and I was able to reach out to the community, and the community helped, and I was successful. The PowerShell community is very open, very helpful. You don't have to feel like you're by yourself in this. There's lots of great information out there. And that's my talk.